Recently, Admiral Vladimir Nikolaevich Chernavin, the last Soviet Navy general commander, was interviewed by Russian media, Russia Today, and revealed two mysterious incidents. Soviet Navy submarines were attacked by multiple flying saucers while trying to explore an underwater cave in the Antarctic continent in 1945. Admiral Chernavin was born in Ukraine in April 1928. As a young man, he studied submarine at the Higher Naval Academy in Baku, and after graduating, he joined the submarine unit of the Soviet Red Navy. In 1951, he became a submarine commander and commanded a November-class nuclear attack submarine on global missions. In 1966, he became the commander of the submarine unit of the Northern Fleet, and in 1977, he became the commander of the Northern Fleet of the Soviet Union. 1981, he became the chief of general staff of the Soviet Navy, and soon after became the commander-in-chief of the Soviet Navy until 1991, when the Soviet Union collapsed. He retired from active service in 1992. His qualifications gave him access to the highest secrets of the Soviet Navy, and his disclosures have a high degree of credibility. In 1945, Nazi Germany had begun to collapse, so the Germans began to implement an emergency evacuation plan, transporting many secret files and treasures to their escape havens, with South America being the main refuge for Nazi Germany. The Nazi Germans used merchant ships and submarines to implement their escape plan. Although the plan was a top secret of Germany, the Soviet intelligence agencies still obtained the relevant information, and Stalin ordered the Soviet Red Navy to follow and intercept the operation. Argentina in South America had long been closed to Germany. Many of the local politicians were descended from German immigrants. The Argentine army was trained by the German military for a long time, and the Argentine political, business, and military circles had a lot of ties with Germany, so Argentina was an important target for the Soviet fleet. At the end of 1945, a Soviet tracking fleet followed a suspicious German merchant ship to the sea off Tierra del Fuego, Argentina. This small fleet consisted of two Soviet merchant ships and a K-class ocean-going submarine, the most advanced Soviet ship of its time. The merchant ships provided cover for the submarines from the US Navy and British Air Force stationed in the Falklands, and also provided support for the K-21 submarine. The K-21 submarines were responsible for tracking German submarines covered by German merchant ships. Off the coast of Tierra del Fuego, the Soviets spotted German merchant ships heading to a nearby port, while the K-21 single-quote sonar picked up that the German submarine was continuing to head south. So the Soviets watched the German merchant ships in port, while the K-21 submarine, following the German submarine, headed for the Antarctic continent. Near a coastal cliff, the Germans lost track of the submarine. The K-21 commander ordered the submarine to dive slowly along the cliff and searched for the German submarine using sonar. The sonar showed that the cliff was several hundred meters deep, and the echoes from the cliff gave a lot of interference to the sonar system. Just when the Soviet captain thought that the operation was likely to fail due to missing targets, the sonar officer reported that there was probably a huge cave on the cliff ahead, 100 meters below the water surface. The captain ordered the submarine to conduct a precise sonar scan of the cave, and found that the cave was so large that it could accommodate several submarines entering at the same time, and that the cave was so deep that sonar could not detect its depth at all. So did the German submarine enter this cave? The K-21 submarine surfaced and used the long-wave radio to contact the Soviet naval headquarters. Soon, the Soviet high command gave direct orders to the K-21 to enter the cave and search for the German submarine. At the moment when the K-21 submarine started to dive, three disc-shaped objects suddenly appeared from the bottom of the water. which were less than 300 meters away from the K-21 submarine, and their presence was not detected by the submarine's sonar. The three sources jumped out of the water silently and hovered less than 30 meters above the water. They looked like three flattened bowler hats, with a dull gray appearance, no windows or seams visible, and no sound. A light suddenly began to shine from underneath the middle saucer. The submarine captain looked through his periscope and saw clearly that the flashing light was Morse code, a code that every Navy officer is familiar with. The coded message is, "Please do not proceed, this is not a place for you to be. Please leave immediately." At the same time, all the submariners heard a voice that seemed to be ringing in everyone's ears, but not from the same fixed source. The voice was a male voice, speaking in standard Russian with the same message as Morse code, "Please don't go any further, this is not a place for you to be. Please leave immediately." The voice was repeated 8 times. The captain moved his eyes away from the periscope and looked to his subordinates beside him, each conveying the same meaning with an astonished yet unanimous look. "Did you hear that voice?" The captain ordered to stop the dive, put out the antenna, and contact the Soviet headquarters by radio, while giving the order to prepare for engagement. The sailors began running to their battle stations, while the telegraphist began trying to contact headquarters. But the telegraphist immediately found that the radio had gone silent, and he could neither send nor receive any messages. And the sailors at various battle stations kept reporting that their weapons systems appeared to be out of order. There was very little electronic instrumentation in those days, mainly mechanical instrumentation. But the various instrumentation hands were spinning about as if they were affected by a strong magnetic field. The captain had no choice but to give a surfacing order, but fortunately, the submarine's navigation system was fine and K-21 surfaced again. The captain went to the bridge and used binoculars to look at the three flying saucers that were hovering silently a few hundred meters away. The captain ordered the signalman, with a searchlight, to send out a message with Morse code to the flying saucers. "We are a Soviet Navy Red October submarine, we are not hostile, who are you, please identify yourselves." The signalman kept sending messages to the other side, but the three flying saucers did not respond and just hovered silently in the air. The political commissar, who was standing beside the captain, asked the captain, "Comrade captain, shouldn't we carry out Comrade Starling's order to continue our operation and move forward?" The captain thought for a moment and said to the political commissar, "Comrade, I am very willing to continue to carry out the orders of the Supreme Leader, but there is one thing I am obliged to point out. Since the other side can interfere with our weapons system, it can also interfere with the whole submarine and make us lose control and sink in the sea. It doesn't matter if we sacrifice, but our glorious mission will not be accomplished, and we will not be able to contact the headquarters. And all the valuable information here will not be able to tell our motherland, and the K-21 submarine, the valuable property of this country, will be lost here for nothing." The commissar cocked his head and said to the captain, "So what you mean is, we turn around and leave?" The captain immediately corrected him, "No, Comrade Commissar, we are retreating in order to bring the information from here back to headquarters. It was also a decision made so that we could be ready to come back again to finish the mission." These two highest-ranking officers in the submarine reached a consensus in an official-like conversation and found a stepping stone. So the captain of the boat ordered them to turn around and leave the place. The K-21 submarine started to return, and the Soviet sailors noticed that the flying saucer was always following them at a distance of several hundred meters when the K-21 was already far away from this craggy coast. The saucer that was following them suddenly whooshed and flew away without a trace. In the words of the sailors, it was as fast as a bullet, and suddenly it flew away. The K-21 eventually returned to the Soviet Union, and the whole incident was investigated by a joint naval and KGB investigation team for months, and because it was so unbelievable. The report of this incident was classified as suspicious by the highest Soviet authorities. And the members of the K-21 submarine were transferred to serve in different units separately because they were not trusted. But 2 years later, in 1947, the KGB spies in the United States obtained information that two US Navy submarines also went to the same waters. They found the cave and encountered the same flying saucer interception. The daredevil Americans, in the spirit of cowboys, tried to go through hard. And the result was really like the K-21 submarine captain predicted. The US submarine was completely out of control and almost sank under the water, fortunately at the last moment. The flying saucer showed mercy and allowed the US submarine to regain control and make an emergency surfacing. Intelligence also showed that after the US submarine surfaced, even the water surface was suddenly a mist, completely unable to see around, only a beam of light, guiding the US submarine out of there, and by the time the US submarine sailed out of the mist, it was already 15 nautical miles away from that cliff. Admiral Janavin also revealed that the Soviet Navy twice sent the most advanced cruiser and submarine formations of the Soviet Union in the mid-1962 and early 1980s to try to explore the mysterious cave again, but on both occasions, all the equipment on board began to show abnormalities when they approached the area by tens of nautical miles, and the mission had to be abandoned. Admiral Chirivine also said that in 1960, he commanded a nuclear attack submarine, a cover nuclear strategic missile submarine on a mission in the Arctic Ocean. When he simulated a nuclear missile attack, he encountered flying saucer surveillance. This is another story. That's it for this issue. See you next time.